गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, कैन यू हियर मी
यस
सर?
यस
ओके, ग्रेट. सो गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, वेलकम टू द क्लास ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन रिट्रीवल. सो लेट्स वेट फॉर अनदर 1 or 2 minutes, सिंस इट्स अ फर्स्ट क्लास. सो होपफुली स्टूडेंट्स आर ट्राइंग टू जॉइन द क्लास. सो मीनवाइल, आई एज्यूम ऑल ऑफ यू हैव ऑलरेडी जॉइंड गूगल क्लासरूम. Is here anyone who haven't joined the Google Classroom? So let me share the class code. So meanwhile, others are joining. So I request you to Google Classroom in case you have finalized taking this course. If not, if you are still shopping the courses, then probably you can wait. So here is the Google Classroom code. So please join if you haven't joined so far. Okay, so we will start in 1 minute. And meanwhile, so please join Google Classroom in case you haven't joined it. Okay, so let's get started. And so thank you everyone for your interest to join this class. So let me share my screen and we can immediately get started. Okay. So I hope you can see my screen, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So let me do one thing. Sorry. Okay. So again, good morning to everyone. So let's get started. I assume most of the people has already joined. So I will be taking information retrieval in this semester, and so I will be offering this course for the first time. So before me, Professor Tanmay was taking this course for last 3 years, and so overall the structure will be the same as last year's. The only thing probably we'll be doing, probably we will be adding more, you can say, at least some introduction about multimedia information retrieval as well, because the previous course is mainly focusing about the text-based information retrieval-based system. So definitely majority of the part of the course will remain the same, but we'll try to add some multimedia retrieval part there, because the human need is not limited to only the text-based information retrieval system, right? So with this note, let me start the class. So feel free to ask any question in between. And so if there are so many interruption, in that case, you please raise your hand when I say the interruption. If so many people ask question at the same time, it will be chaos. So better raise your hand and probably ask. And if there is only one person, you can directly unmute yourself and ask the question, whatever you have. Okay, so this particular course, CSE 508, Information Retrieval System, is many resources will be taken from the CS 276, Information Retrieval and Web Search by Christopher Manning and Pandu Naik at Stanford University. So you can also refer to the course material there. At least in my class, there is no compulsory attendance, right? So I don't want to force anyone. I'm sure, I mean, if you attend the class, you will learn a lot, and hopefully you will get more than what is covered in the actual base slides. That is our aim. So we will use the base slides from there and we'll update based on our information need and so on. So we'll do a lot of changes in the base slides. So you can refer to a slide, but again, there is no compulsion, there is no mandatory attendance. So it is up to you whether you want to attend the class or not. So if you're attending, so I just request you to not disturb the class by talking in between, by doing irrelevant chat in the chat box. So I basically request you to not do so. So, I mean, some of the TAs will also be following, I mean, the chat box and probably following whole the class. So if you'll be doing something irrelevant, I mean, we don't have any other option, then please kindly request you to leave the class. Okay. So please feel free to ask questions in between, because it's not only I'm going to speak, right? I mean, I don't want to have all the fun alone. I mean, you also have to speak in between. You also have to ask questions. You also have to respond to different questions I will be asking to you. So feel free to interact. Let's make this class more interactive rather than just one-sided. Yeah, so before we start the class, so I want to spend 2 minutes on participating in this survey. So let me share the, anyways, I mean, you can just simply clear, open this link, simply tinyurl.com/cs502508-survey. Could you please fill the survey? So let me share the link in the chat box as well. So will lectures be regularly recorded and shared? Yeah, so we do plan to record the lectures and share. Okay, so this is the Google Classroom. So here is the link. So please fill this survey. Okay, so we can see some responses. So far, most of the responses, 90%, 99, okay, 90.9, we take. So we do have some MTech student as well, that's good. Yeah, so the questions are very simple. I mean, it shouldn't take much time to you. So we just, the reason we are doing this survey is just to understand your background. And that will help us to basically choose the different projects and probably the different course material for you. Okay. So it looked like more US elections. Now Democratic kind of, Republican is kind of going to overtake Republican. Okay, so they are very close. I hope Trump won't come and say it's cheating. Okay. Okay. Yeah, it's a close fight between, yeah, Republican and Democratic. Cool. Yeah, that's good to see and a bit surprised to see. I mean, the number of MTech students are much more than BTech, at least in this class, which usually I haven't seen so far, at least in my previous courses. But anyways, that's good. So it seems 166 people have, 68 people have responded. So let me see how many people in the class at the moment. So we have over 200 people. So I assume we can expect probably another 30 responses in next 1 minute. Okay, so those who haven't filled the survey, so I request you to please fill in next 1 minute. It won't take much time. So since most of the students are first year, so I believe they are from MTech first year because the BTech first year cannot take the course. And which stream have you enrolled to? So most of them CS plus X, but it's good to see, I mean, the student from different streams are attending this class. That's good. So have you taken an LP course before? No, that's fine. Even though you have not taken, it shouldn't be much issue. We'll be covering a lot of details of NLP here because we are going to process the text in order to understand what you mean. Have you taken ML course before? Yes, that is good. It's good to have some ML background. So how much proficient are you with NLP? Somewhat, okay. So I believe some of the TAs are here. So I will be needing your help in further processing this after the class. And we can determine what to do next after this. Okay, so I believe we are done with the survey. And so those who haven't filled, so I request them to probably fill the survey after the class, or probably they can fill during the class. It won't take much time to them. Okay. So thanks for taking the survey. I hope you can still hear me. Can anyone just acknowledge that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, wonderful. Wonderful. Okay, so we are done with the survey. So thank you so much for that. So as you can see, I mean, most of the people have some background. They have some background in NLP. Some of them don't have. Similarly, some of them have a machine learning background. So that's fine. I mean, this is something, I mean, we'll be learning over the class. Before I go next, I want to show what are you going to do here in this particular course. I mean, let's play some simple video, and I hope you just heard the audio of this particular video as well, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. So let me play the video.
My name's Lowry. Sam Lowry. I've been told to report to Mr. Warren.
30th floor, sir. You're expected.
Anyone to search me?
No, sir.
You want to see my ID?
No need, sir.
But I could be anybody.
No, you couldn't, sir. This is information retrieval. The lifts arrive, sir.
Probably this is each of you entering the CSE 508 class, and let's see how you are welcomed in the class. Thank you.
Calvus terrorist, the restless victim.
Mr. Warren.
Yes.
Mr. Warren.
No.
Yes, this is facts.
Definitely no.
My name's Larry, Mr. Warren. Sam Larry.
Ah, Larry. Yes.
Is it, sir?
No. Cancel that. Okay. Yes. No, don't be ridiculous, Jenkins. Yes, yes, yes. You like it up here? This send that back. We've got a crack team of, are they kidding, decision makers. No, in triplicate. I'm expecting big things to publish the finance of you. Progress see those. Between you and me, Larry, this no, no, department. Tell records to get stuff. It's about to be upgraded and the... Ah! Here we are. Your very own number on your very own door. And behind that door, your very own office. Congratulations, DZ stroke 015. Welcome to the team. Yes. No. Cancel that. Send two copies to my...
Okay, so welcome to the class of information retrieval. So this is how you're going to do. So yeah, so I mean, you're going to join how the information retrieval team works. How, anyways, I mean, before I say something, I would like to hear what is your first reaction. So please raise your hand so that I can see, I mean, who want to respond. Your first reaction, anyone? Anyone? Otherwise, I will have to simply, ask some random names. Akansha, would you like to say something?
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. So in my I don't have the words to express, but it's like what I understood from here is like information retrieval. You can retrieve the information. You just need to not need to explicitly see or say the things, but the information is retrieved or something like that.
Okay. Anyone else?
It is good to see that in the movies. The direct concept is being implemented without any just modifying it, because we can see that directly the information retrieval name is being taken and directly things are being just implemented the way they are not just modified as per the movie enthusiasm and something. So it was like crazy to see this thing.
Yeah. So anyone else before we go further?
Abhishek
Madan, would you like to comment? Yeah, Lokesh, please go ahead.
Yeah, one thing is evident that from the video that information retrieval doesn't work before explicit action.
Yeah.
So when he was said that he must be going to that enter that class, so information retrieval team was going behind that and just showed him that this is the room DZ whatever, and. Also, the receptionist captured his information before ahead.
Exactly.
So it's an automated system.
Yeah, because over the time, you'll also learn, I mean, when you're doing to do any information retrieval. So often, you are going to provide the personalized information retrieval as well, right? Because these days, if you're doing any information retrieval over the internet, right? I mean, so often these results are customized based on your preferences, based on your history, based on many other things, right?
Yes.
Okay, nice. Anyone else? Anyone? Amulya, would you like to comment? Apratim, would you like to come in? Okay, if not, then anyways, that's fine. So I hope you got a bit understanding, I mean, what information retrieval is. As you rightly said, I mean, this is part of the movie, so that may not capture exactly what is information retrieval, because they may not be the exact technical person, but still, I mean, they covered up to some extent, right? Okay, so let's go next. So often people get confused and in fact they are also related as well, search versus retrieval. So can anyone comment on that? I mean, what is your understanding of search and how it is different from retrieval? Anyone?
So search can be like sort of retrieving a group of documents or content as a whole. Mm-hmm. And information retrieval is like more specific. It could be as specific as, for example, search could be like searching for all COVID related papers. Information retrieval could be like searching for a particular protein information in a particular COVID paper.
Like okay. just the relevant data.
Okay. I mean, ideally in searches as well, you need relevant data, right? I mean, you don't want to have probably irrelevant data in the search, right?
Yes, in the search, but in retrieval, it's just the relevant data we fetch.
Okay. Yes. Who's next?
I think so? Search is more static and retrieval has some contextual or like, you know, yeah. a bit more very information
nice.
Than search.
Yeah, very nice. Very nice. Anyone else?
Sir, in search, you need to know what you are searching for. But information retrieval would be something like means gathering all the information that you can from a set of data.
Mm-hmm.
Like that means extracting information about something. And search is what you means you already know what you want to search.
Okay. Arish, you want to comment?
Sir, I want to comment on this.
Yeah, Pradeep, please go ahead.
Search is something that we are finding something in the already present information. Retrieval mm-hmm. is something getting some meaningful insights from the results or retrieving some valuable information.
Okay, nice. Anyone else?
Also, like information retrieval may not always be associated with end user. For example, there could also be like automated extraction from bank transcripts and driving some other applications downstream.
Mm-hmm.
But when we search, can also be that case, like it could be some batch processing, but search is mostly associated with the end user most of the time.
Okay. So, one last response. Yeah, anyone?
Sir, what I can feel is that the search, the target is defined that we have to search over this space and around.
Mm-hmm.
While information can be widespread. So the information retrieval, we don't know the source of the target where we have to search for. So we mm-hmm. have to search in each and every aspect. Whereas in search, we have the target that we have to search in this space only on.
Right. Okay, Arundhati, would you like to comment before we move to next slide, next part? Okay, that's fine. Yeah, so yeah, most of you, I mean, already covered very exactly. So what the major difference between search and retrieval? So searches can be as, just to make it more formal. So searches can be based on full text and other content-based indexing. Right. So often you have all the text, the exact indexing for those document or you can see the text which is you're looking for. Information retrieval is the more science of searching for information in a document, right? Searching for documents themselves and also searching for the metadata that describe and for database of text, image or sounds. So often, as you can see, it's not limited to the text only. I mean, because the human information need is not just text, right? And why the human information need is not just text? Anyone would like to comment?
So actually, sir, like nowadays, the huge and the large number of images and other formats are being generated. So actually, the not only the text is important.
Information can be anything like text or images or maybe video or sounds. So that's why not only text, please.
Exactly. Anything else? Anyone else?
Also, I mean, like, you can try.
Yeah, please go ahead. Please go ahead.
So our cognition and perception, it's like not just based on text input. So basically, like different people understand through various inputs. So it's not just like availability of data in different formats, but the different formats actually serve our reasoning needs and learning additional information, which we don't.
So, very nice. Yeah, so Meet, you want to comment?
Yes, sir. Just taking an example, earlier news was in general transferred using newspaper. Then came the radio and then the television. So starting it was text, then it went to audio. It is basically how much evolution is coming and how much data can be shared. So we have to retrieve the information on all the available kinds of data.
Yeah, very nice. I mean, I believe you know a proverb related to images and words, right? Anybody want to know, tell what this?
Image is 1,000 words.
Exactly, image worth 1,000 words, right? So, I mean, the information that you can carry, that you can convey using an image may have, I mean, you don't have to write 1,000 words, right? Similarly, now, if you go forward, I mean, a video, right? A video, I mean, consists of, so for example, the normal video that you use, I mean, that has frames per second, FPS of say 60 or 30, depends on what type of device you have. So even if it has 60 frames per second, so 1 second video, 1 second video has 60 images. So it's kind of 60,000 words you can worth kind of to the 1 second video. So, I mean, that's why, I mean, and also you can see it like that. So human are kind of one of the best example of multimedia system, right? Human do not just write. Human can read, human can speak, human can hear. Human can basically do the image processing through his eyes and so on, right? So that's why the information needs often not only limited to the text, but it could be anything. So despite, I mean, in this particular class, we'll be focusing more on the text-based information retrieval system, but still we will try to give an overall overview of how the whole, or in fact, any information retrieval system based system work. And if you have to expand your understanding how the image-based retrieval system work, how the video-based information retrieval system work, or probably how the audio-based information retrieval system work, right? So
I want to ask one question, sir. How information retrieval is different from data mining? Like in data mining, we used to get some useful insights from the data or the information that we have. So how it is different from that?
Yeah, so in case of, again, I mean, both are very closely related, similar to the search and retrieval. You cannot, I mean, say it's totally different. Like similarly, the data mining and information retrieval. In case of data mining, you also try to find the more patterns. I mean, you perform a lot of data mining technique like association and number of things, right? So in information retrieval, you may not able to you may not do that much detailed data mining there. But in case of retrieval, I mean, you may assume all the data that already stored in the database that you have. And you perform more similarity. I mean, you may not able to perform that detailed association and data mining technique, right? But you may mostly try to do some similarity metric based on the document that you have, different representation that you'll be converting. So it's also more like in case of retrieval, I mean, we're focusing more on the probabilistic approaches. I mean, it may not be the exact thing. But in data mining, I mean, often it may be, you can treat is like it's more very accurate information that you'll be deriving from data mining. So for example, let me show the next part. So if you see here the data retrieval and the information retrieval. So data retrieval is more close to the data mining, right? So here the results are unordered by the their relevancy, right? Because if you mine data, I mean, do you get in the ordered way? Usually not, right? So, and it is also more deterministic model. But in case of information retrieval, the results are ordered by the relevance, Relevance to whom? Relevance to the your input query, right? And it, as I said, it is more probabilistic model. Am I making sense here?
Right, sir. Right.
Anyone else want to comment? I mean, it's a very nice question, very good question. Anybody want to add or add something? Who all we have? Aswin?
Sir, can I comment?
Yeah, please, go ahead.
Yeah, sir, in information retrieval, it is like, I want to give an example. For example, you want to predict the next word coming from this particular sentence. Let's say I want to predict the next word for a sentence. So it mm-hmm. will come under the information retrieval. From the previous information, you are retrieving a new word for the sentence. But in data retrieval, you can only get particular, from that particular sentence, you are just making some guesses out of that. Maybe something.
Okay. Like that. Yeah. Yeah, nice. So Anmol, you want to add something? Anyone else before we go next?
Sir, will Google search be information retrieval or data retrieval?
Sorry?
Will Google search be information retrieval or data retrieval?
I would say it's more close to the information retrieval. What do you think? Because often, mm-hmm. I mean, they're going to perform more probabilistic search based on your given query.
And the data is also ordered according to relevance.
Yeah, it is. I mean,
mm-hmm.
don't you see? I mean,
yes, it is.
Otherwise, I mean, the Google business is not going to work, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yes.
Because if you see, I mean, if you search anything, right? If you search anything, you will see, I mean, text like in 0.001 second, I retrieve, say, 10,000 relevant document to you, right?
Yes. So, yeah, but sir, one more thing, sir, in data mining also, when we retrieve data, it's mostly based on confidence and the confidence values that we give previously. So we can also say that the data that has been mined is also based on some relevancy according to the confidence value or support value that we gave before.
Yeah, that's why I said, I mean, there is not very, I mean, they are related, but you cannot say, I mean, they're totally different. But in case of here we try to compute. I mean, in information retrieval, that is the key. I mean, you'll get all the result ordered by the relevance.
Okay.
Yeah. So can you tell us about the difference between probabilistic model and deterministic model? Exactly what is it?
Oh, so deterministic model is more like every time you'll get the same results. I mean, deterministic, I mean, it's same. In probabilistic model, I mean, the probabilistic change over the time, because suppose you are working something, right? I mean, over the time, the prior can change. Over the time, some other probability, the confidence, I mean, that you have, that can change. So the result may change, right? So it will come with more, you can say, the confidence-based, the probability-based retrieval. Okay? So let's basically try some information retrieval by information retrieval by ourselves, right? So just to give before that, let's give a formal definition of information retrieval. So in case information retrieval is IR is finding material usually document. So again, it's a usually document, not limited to documents, of an unstructured nature. Again, unstructured is usually text. And that satisfies an information need from within large collection and usually stored in computer or data center or probably, okay, it could be even the large database that you have. So these days, we frequently think first of web search, but again, so there are many other cases that you perform information retrieval. So it's email search, searching your laptop, corporate knowledge bases, legal information retrieval, and many others. So why do you need to study information retrieval? Anyone want to come in?
Sir, this is the information age. So any kind of information that we can extract and can be used in various forms, like in marketing or in where we can decipher a when we can conclude a bigger scheme of things from the information collected, it is useful to us. So we always try to get information from anything and everything.
Sir, data is growing by every passing day. So actually, to retrieve the relevant data, that comes the question around that there must be a means, there must be some technique so that we can extract the relevant information rather than the pool of information.
Exactly.
Pool of data.
Exactly.
Sir, and also like it can serve other fields, like the in the recent pandemic, like relevant information will really help will help accelerate the vaccine development. For example, Pfizer outsourced a project to build a data retrieval system to like Samatech. And that they predicted that that really helped them accelerate by about like 60 days or something in the right direction. So these data management and data retrieval or information retrieval systems help accelerate discovery and other tasks in other fields.
So how does the information help people? I mean, yeah, so you have a query, you need some information. Now the probably some IR-based system give you information. So how these information help you further?
Sir, it helps in decision making if you want to make a very good, yes, sir.
What kind of decision you can expect?
It may be like business decisions. It may be like some product, for example, self-driving cars, making some decisions out of the information available, something like that.
Okay. Anybody else?
So in WhatsApp, like they are taking our information to give us better recommendations of the product. That is one use case.
Yeah, but at least WhatsApp, I mean, they are kind of trying to retrieve a lot of private information, right? And that is the issue, right? I mean, so have you agreed to, I mean, the WhatsApp new policy?
Yes, sir.
Currently, yes, because all are in WhatsApp.
Okay. So often, I mean, the people retrieve information, right? Again, the people can use for different purposes, as you rightly mentioned. It could be for business. It could be for taking some policy decision and so on, right? So let's try our hand of information retrieval by ourselves. So, for example,
I'm Joe Biden. This is the Wired autocomplete interview I'm about to do.
Have you ever Googled yourself before?
No, I try not to. First card here. Is Joe Biden a Democrat or Republican? What a silly question, man. What else would you be but a Democrat? I'd have to change my name if I weren't a Democrat. My grandfather Finney would come back from his grave. All right, is Joe Biden running for president? Yes, I am. I'm running for president. Is Joe Biden going to win? As my grandfather would say, the grace of God, the goodwill of the neighbors, and the creek not rising, yes, I'm going to win. Is Joe Biden a billionaire? Unfortunately, I'm not. Okay, is Joe Biden religious? I do not proselytize, but I'm a practicing Catholic, yes. Is Joe Biden Irish? Absolutely. My mom's side 100% Irish, and my dad's side half Irish. We don't admit to the other part.
So I hope this example is one of the supporting example. Why do we need information retrieval? Because not everyone has access to, the Joe Biden in order to get the response to these questions, right? In fact, before this video, I was not aware he was Irish. But anyways, so often people have, if you watch this particular video, the people has asked so many questions to him, at least search about him. And it is interesting to see, information retrieval-based system, ideally, search or, do the matching over all the huge amount of document which are available online and provide the answer, right? So that's why we need, basically, because the human are full of questions. They keep asking questions to satisfy their understanding, to basically have more knowledge, to satisfy their curiosity, and so on, right? So So in this way, you can see, I mean, if we have such system, then probably it can help you a lot. So for example, what about Rajiv Ratasha? I mean, how you can retrieve some information about me? I mean, what you'll do? What is the first step you'll think? Anyone?
I'll be Googling you.
Okay, so try Googling, what you'll get? Could you do a
university
quick
Google page? And
can you
Google
do a quick Google search?
Sir, I will ask yourself.
We are getting a triple IT Delhi page of yours.
Okay. Yes, you. Someone is saying something.
Sir, I will ask yourself.
Okay, that is also. But yeah, so it's very that is also thing. So often, I mean, information which are available and you can ask. Okay, so that's nice. So if you see, I mean, for example, if you have done the Google search by yourself, I mean, you'll get all those information, right? I mean, at least in case of Google, you'll get some suggestions as well. Do anybody know what these suggestions are?
The searches, the old searches.
Is it? Are you sure these are the old searches? That's why I opened this particular thing in Ignati mode. So let me show this. So for example, I think, yeah.
It is also appending your name with Midas.
Okay. So in that case, I mean, why do you think the Punurangam Kumar Guru name is here? Why do you think Yaman Kumar is
because
here? I mean, there is
your,
no...
sir, related with IIITD and PK sir is also related to IIITD, so that's why maybe...
No, I mean, in IIIT there is a lot of people are there. I mean, at least 100 faculties are there, right? So
sir,
why PK, not others?
I think those are the keywords that must have been picked up by the system.
So maybe the people who search for you also search for
probability is more.
Mm-hmm.
Probability of searching PK sir and you and Yaman Kumar sir is higher than others. That's why
like,
it's showing up.
That's not the myth. You have raised your hand. You want to answer?
Yes, sir. These words are closely related to your name, closely associated with your name. That is why these are showing in the top search.
So, I mean, so have you heard of something called, so for example, so this is the, I mean, I just write Rajiv Ratnasha in the Google and let me, so the Google is one of the search engine, right? Are you aware of any other search engine?
DuckDuckGo.
Bing. Yahoo
Bing.
Search.
So let me do, okay, so Yahoo search. So let me do the same thing in, so let me write the same thing here. I did not get any other suggestions, right? So for
just
example-
press space maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Just press space after your name.
Okay, I've given space.
Yes, sir. That's, I think, because of the previous searches, like previously, most of the people that must have searched your name, they must have also followed the different links that were coming after that. So
Not exactly.
Sir, I think most of the people have searched your name on Google only. That's why it's not coming because it has not have some metadata on your name.
Is it?
The reason for it is both of you are having quite some affiliations, maybe some research projects or which is being hit on Google. That's maybe it could be Google Scholar and it's not usually searched on Bing. It's generally searched on Google. That's the reason why
so
it is.
How many have heard of something called knowledge graphs?
Yes, sir.
Anybody heard of knowledge graphs?
Yes.
Yes,
so
sir.
Whole this thing is, you can say, kind of, because this is the key for the Google's business. I mean, because before Google, there was Yahoo search who was doing very well. Even the Bing was completely doing well. So they are all doing well. So after the inception of knowledge graph, the Google has kind of, I mean, defeated everyone in the search engine space. Because the Google search, I mean, the result that you're seeing here, I mean, they are based on the knowledge graph. So knowledge graph, I mean, you can say it's kind of graph how the different information are connected to each other. So for example, PK. So I mean, me and PK work very closely on different projects. So that's why, I mean, there is a lot of document and the information available over the internet where basically we collaborate, we work. And that's why, I mean, the Google knowledge graph thing, I mean, yeah, so that's relevant. Similarly, I mean, the Midas is very obvious. But for example, Yaman Kumar don't have any Rajiv Ratnasar name. But I mean, since he is my PhD student, I mean, we are working together for a long time. We already have a number of papers and so on. So that's how there is a linkages in the graph, right? And how this is how the knowledge graph basically help you in auto-filling all those details. Am I clear here?
Sir, I have a question linked to this. So like you have typed your name and you are getting some suggestions. So every user will get similar kind of suggestions, or it depends on user also, because I have typed the similar name, but I'm not getting any of these suggestions. I'm getting just different suggestions. So like how these things work, like, is it also the end user dependent, or is it just a knowledge graph? Because
it's just not a knowledge graph. Knowledge graph is one aspect. And after that, I mean, later on, I mean, we'll be studying in information retrieval. I mean, ideally I think you should get the similar result here, at least in this case, unless I mean you are much biased towards probably something else. In that case, basically what happens, once you get the ranked list of results, and there is a concept called relevance feedback. So that relevance feedback is basically update the ranking of the result that you're getting based on some relevance, or you can say there's some feedback that you provide to the result that you're getting. So later on, I mean, we'll be discussing in more details. I mean, so here we are not providing direct feedback to the system, but based on your, you can say the search result, based on your, you can say cache or probably other history that you have. So that relevance has been sent to, you can say, the Google result, and that may be slightly updated based on that. So that concept we'll be studying in more details in the upcoming classes and the slides. I mean, how the information retrieval results are, you can say, the further change based on your relevance, and the feedback. Okay.
Like on Flipkart and Google, Flipkart or Amazon, we search for the relevant product. They store the cookies for content personalization.
Yeah.
That also comes under IR.
Yeah, so in a way, I mean, yeah, in a way, yes, because you are retrieving some document, and e-commerce website as well, you get the ranked result, right?
Yes.
You get the ranked result, and that ranked result is based on the whatever the history that you have, whatever the cookies, as you mentioned, you have. So that is updated. That is the relevance feedback, because I mean, we'll be doing studying later. I mean, one possible way, I mean, if you're doing information retrieval, you provide the direct feedback to the system. But when you're doing the Google search here, are you providing any direct feedback to the system? No, right? When you are studying or building any system, you also want to minimize the human intervention, right? Otherwise, I mean, the human will, a lot of intervention are required, and the people won't satisfied with the result they are getting. I mean, they may get satisfied, but it probably overall turnaround time will be more, right? Because human are the laziest people, right? I mean, ideally, they want to have all the result without doing anything. Because I want to build a system. I want to build an information retrieval based system where even I don't want to write. Why I should write? I mean, I just think about it and get the result, right? Am I clear here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So in this way, I mean, as you can see, I mean, you can retrieve the results. Anybody know why the Rajiv Ratnasar IAS are mentioned here? I am not an IAS, right? How the Google?
कोई IAS होगा जिनका नाम भी राजीव रतन शाह हो.
Is it?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
This is Indronil this side, and I was just curious about this thing as well just 2 minutes back, and I googled it up, so I got something. So you were named up after the Prime Minister Rajiv Ratan, who was an IAS, and so this is what happened.
probably you mix up something. So I think you have searched. So it's a very interesting story behind this. So in fact, I have done the information retrieval to find the person. So just it may not be very relevant to the class, but somehow related to the information retrieval. So in fact, my name was Rajiv. And at that time, the Prime Minister Rajiv Ratan was there, Rajiv Ratan Gandhi. So my name was changed to Rajiv Ratan. And when I started my schooling, I mean, the commissioner of Banaras, I'm from Banaras, by the way, was Rajiv Ratna Shah. So, I mean, my parents got fascinated. They think, I mean, yes, I can be IAS one day. And they have changed my name from Rajiv Ratan to Rajiv Ratna Shah. So I was aware of this story. I mean, when I came to Delhi for my higher studies, and so I thought, I mean, what to do? I mean, so I heard about this story, but I never tried to find the person. Then I've done the information retrieval, and I found that the particular person, Rajiv Ratna Shah, was IAS, and at that time in 1984-85, I mean, he was the IAS commissioner of Banaras, my city. And so when I came here, I tried to find the detail about the person. And so he was the chief secretary of Prasar Bharati. And I got more interest and tried to contact him. And fortunately, sent to Google, retrieved the information for me. And I got the email ID and other things. And I contacted the person, we met, and it was a great story. It was great, interesting, at least story for me. So in this way, probably because Rajiv Ratna Shah is one of the IAS, I mean, the India has, and probably there might be many other people, but the Google shows some kind of IAS result mainly because there is a person named Rajiv Ratna Shah who is IAS and so on, right? So similarly, I mean, we have IIIT Delhi, this is obvious. Google Scholar. So how many of you heard of Google Scholar? Anybody want to comment? What is Google Scholar?
Yeah, hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, so it's like a database, or you can say a website, where we can find relevant information about all the like the professors or scholars or researchers across the world.
Right. So you may just think it like the way you perform Google search or Google information retrieval using the normal search engine, right? So using Google Scholar, you do the same thing for the research paper or probably the documents related to the research and so on, right? So I will just show a small details. I mean, that may not be useful for everyone, but I just want to show because that is good to know. So if you see here, I mean, if you go to my Google Scholar page, you'll find different numbers. So are you aware of these numbers? What are these numbers, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what is citations?
Should I go forward?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. So citations are the number of times your papers that you have published has been cited by other has been cited by other researchers.
Okay,
like by doing their work, they cite their your work.
Very nice. And how about ITIN index?
ITIN index is the number of your papers which has been cited by more than 10 times.
Very nice. And how about H index?
Okay, H index is the parameter which basically means, okay, so I take the number 22 here. So that means you have 22 such papers which has been cited more than or equal to 22 times.
Yeah, very nice. I mean, you explained perfectly. So I hope this will be useful for others as well. So these numbers, especially since most of the students here are in M-Tech, right? I mean, I think it is very much useful for you to know what these numbers are, because many of you probably will be going for PhD or probably further higher studies, and even the BTEC student often go, right? So these are very important numbers, and these basically also help you to somehow determine how well you are doing. Anyways,
sir, can you explain the H index again?
So H index is mostly, I mean, how your work is doing as compared to the other works. So for example, here H index 22 means because I may have many papers, right? For example, I have at least 44 paper here that you can see. So how H index is saying, it's more how my particular paper, different papers are. So for example, suppose I publish 100 papers. So how my different papers say, for example, top 10 papers, top 20 papers, top 25 papers are working or doing as compared to the remaining papers. So this is very simple metric. Here you say H-index 22 means at least my 22 papers having citation of at least 22. So for example, this paper is having 68 citations, right? So this is one of the, so if you go down, I mean, at least 23, as you can see, if you go down further, I mean, the at least the 22 papers are having at least 22 citations. And after, if you go my papers beyond 22, I mean, they have less than 22 citations. That's why, I mean, because these numbers will be increased like that. Suppose it has 23, in that case, at least my 23 papers will need to have at least 23 citations. So it will work like that. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
It refers to the number of people referred your paper?
No, it is comparison to your paper only. So I-10 index is more, I mean, how many your papers are at least 10 citation. H-index is how your papers are doing as compared to the rest of your papers. You can see the top papers. So for example, what I'm saying here, I mean, the first 22 papers, for example, here, if you see 23, so my H-index is not 23 because there might be some paper which has less than 23 citations. So for example, here, so if you see here, so for example, if these three papers will get at least one more or two more citations, so my H-index will be 23 and so on. Okay. So, I mean, I hope, I mean, it is clear. If not, then probably we can take it offline as well. So how these numbers do you interpret? I mean, like 30, 70 is like overall citation. How do you interpret these numbers? And what do you think? What do you think is the highest number of citation you are aware of? I mean, suppose 30, 70 is my citation. What do you think is the highest citation would be for someone?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
For someone means as in like anyone from anyone. Our college or
no,
like
anyone in the world.
It must be in some. I don't know. Maybe 1 lakh or maybe even 1.5 lakh.
1.5 lakh. Okay. And who the person would be if you have to name a person?
Okay. I don't necessarily come up with a name right now, but mm-hmm. there must be someone because I have seen people having 60,000-70,000 citations.
It may be, I can guess, Jeffrey Hinton.
So, for example, I just search Jitendra Malik. I mean, he's a professor. Right. So Jitendra Malik is one of the very popular professor in area of computer vision, and he's a professor at UC Berkeley. And you can see he's close to 2 lakh citation. And someone has rightly mentioned the name of Jeffrey Hinton. 4 lakh plus citations. You can see every year is close to getting 82,000 citations, which I mean, kind of near possible for many people, right? So I hope how the Google is working, you can see at least in the Google Scholar, right? Okay, nice. So let's get back to the class. So this is the some course logistic in the brief. So myself is Rajiv. You can reach to me using this email ID anytime. And so we have following PAs who will be helping you throughout the course. So we have Abhishek, Anmol, Avinash, Tulsi, Himant Yadav, Pragya Srivastav, Rahul Kukreja, and Ritik Sharma. And probably we may have one more TA based on how many students will be taking this course. Okay, so let's have very, very quick introduction with the TAs as well. Abhishek, would you like to go if you are here? I don't know if you are here.
Yes, sir. Myself, Abhishek, and I will be working with you throughout the semester. So if you have any doubts, please come contact me. I will be sharing my meeting hours today only. So yeah, that's all. Sir.
Anmol?
Hello, sir. Hello, everyone. I'm Anmol, and I'll be your TA for the semester. I'm looking forward to the experience, and I hope that it is a good learning opportunity for all of us. I'll also share my office hours, and feel free to connect whenever required. And
so before, so thanks Anmol and Abhishek. So before probably we go for the rest of the TAs, what I think, because many times if you share office hours, there could be two possibilities, right? One, you book appointment time, but often that may not be, and especially the class is going to be very big, at least 200 plus student, I can assume, right? So what I'm planning to do, I'm going to divide the class into different small groups, right? And I will be going to assign each group to different TAs, so that after every class in the evening or some office hour that you can decide, we can decide whether it has to be after every class or at least once in a week. What do you think? I mean, should we have after every class or should we have once in a week?
Students, sir, once in a week.
Once in a week. So that is from the TAs. And how about the students? I mean, do you think the doubt clearing session once in a week is fine to you? Students? Or do you think, it is required?
Yes, once in a week.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, yes, once sir. In a week is fine. Okay, wonderful. So what I will do, we would like to set up 1 hour, 1 hour doubt clearing session. I mean, that you can treat as an office hour for the TA. TAs are free to basically choose that office hour based on the groups assigned to them. Because if all the students are in the assigned group are fine with whatever the time TA is suggesting, that's good. If not, then simply you can set up a office hour after the office hours, I would say. That is 5:30 to 6:30, you can set up on any day. We can do once in a week. Is it fine with all of you? Okay, I assume this silence as a fine with you. And regarding me, you can set up any meeting, just dropping an email and I will be very happy to help you. So that is about the course logistic. Regarding the evaluation, we are going to have midterm evaluation 25%, interim 25%, quizzes 10%, assignment and the project 40%. We are going to follow this particular book by Christopher D. Manning. And yeah, so we are not having any grade for attendance. Earlier I used to have, but since it's an offline since it's online classes, many times it's difficult to follow due to many reasons. And also I don't want to hold anyone, force anyone to basically attend the class. If they don't want to, they don't need to. But I'm sure, if they're attending the class, they will learn, at least from the class, from the discussion that we are having. So I encourage strongly to attend the class, but there is no compulsion from our side. One request, if you are attending the class, don't disturb the class. That's it. That's only requirement we have, right?
Sir, there are comments in the chat.
Okay, there are some comments in the chat. Let me see. Okay. So what will be the team size for the project? That we'll be discussing, don't worry. So because the team size often depends on how big is the class, right? So we will be letting you know about that. What are the other classes? What are the other questions we have? Okay, I think that's
it. What would be the format for the midterm and the end term? Would it be like a couple of hours or would it be like a day or something?
That we have to still, I will have to discuss with TAs what are the possibilities, and based on the experience of my fellow colleagues in the last semester, I will be deciding on that. Okay, so I cannot confirm at the moment, but most likely it may be a mix of MCQs and probably some questions. You may give in a couple of hours to complete that. Okay.
So how many assignments will be there?
We may have 3 to 4 assignments.
Sir, assignments will be individual or in group?
If there are 200 plus students, it will be difficult for us to do individual assignment because we also have to evaluate, right? So we'll see what the best we can do. But most of the assignment, at least major of them, we may do. Group, but there will be definitely some individual assignment as well. Otherwise, how you learn, right? Because ultimate aim is we want you to learn We want you to code and so on. So there will be some individual assignment, but majority of them may be the group assignment because there are 200 plus students. It's very difficult to individually assess everything, right? Any other comments, questions?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Will there be any best of K assignments or quizzes like that? Best and
I mean, we can do. I mean, usually in my case, I'm very open to all these things, right? I mean, if students want best of three, I mean, not best of three. I mean, out of four assignments, you want to consider best of three, I'm fine. I mean, that decision usually we take along the class and without, and with basically consulting after you. It's not, I mean, I just impose on you. Okay. So that we can discuss over the class.
Sir, assuming that there are 200 students in the course, what could be the rough team size?
What will be the
rough team size?
Team size. Okay. I will have to speak to the students, my TAs. So ideally, it may be four to five or five to six students in a group. So on average, you can assume five. On average, probably the five students in a group. But if some students are fine with doing alone, I don't have an issue. But don't assume that if you're working alone, we assume that, I mean, since you have worked alone, we are going to provide any relaxation, right? So just keep that in mind. I mean, whether you work in a group of three, four, five, or six, or alone, the evaluation metric will be the same. You will be judged based on the output that you have produced rather than your team size. And regarding relative or absolute marking scheme. So in my course, I follow the relative grading, relative marking scheme. So yeah, okay.
Excuse me, hi sir. Sir, what will be the time? What will be the time provided for each assignment that we will be having in the course?
So usually for the assignment, we give at least 1 week time for the assignments. Because usually, I mean, for the group project, I mean, they require more time, but the assignments, I mean, usually they are not more than 1 week long. And again, I mean, if you think, I mean, after the discussion, students need more time, we can discuss. And if I really think, I mean, more time should be given, I'm very happy to probably extend the timeline.
Just a clarification, sir. So you mentioned 4 to 5, the group size. Is it for both assignment or project or only for the project?
So the thing is, if the assignment is group assignment, so your group will be fixed, right? It's not like, I mean, for assignment, you'll be having different groups and for project, you'll be having different groups, right? It will be the same. So if it is specified that the assignment is group assignment, you'll have to do in the group. If it is individual assignment, then it's clear, right? You'll have to do alone.
Okay.
Given that there are so many MTech students and in the course, do we have a separate grading for MTechs and BTechs? Or
no,
it's a common grading?
Not at all. Not at all. I mean, the grading scheme will be the same irrespective of whether they are MTech, BTech, PhD.
Okay.
Any other questions?
So is
yeah,
the 40-
one more thing I want... One more thing, yeah. One more thing I want to at least clarify in my class. So group doesn't mean that every student in the group will get the same mark or the same you can say the grade. The reason being, often the people take it for granted. Like if I'm part of the group, teen log kar rahe hain, to yaar mujhe karne ki zarurat nahi hai. So I strictly warn, if you are working in a group, everyone will have to contribute to the group project. And I have different mechanism, at least in my courses, to judge if everyone is contributing or not. I do different surveys in between. And so just make sure that your group members are satisfied with you and you are also contributing equally to the project. Is it fine with you? The idea is everyone has to work. I mean, you cannot just think, I mean, your other project members will work and you will have fun. So that is not at least the case in my courses.
Sir, can there be a possibility that, like, for the group assignments, a person is in a group and he does the project alone, or is it mandatory that he has to continue with the same group? Because, like, the ideas for the project may be different.
No. So that will be difficult for us to, in that case, then follow who, because, I mean, just think in that way. I mean, we also have to evaluate and a lot of things, right? If for different assignment, you will have different group, for the project, you will have different group. I mean, it is very, very hard for us to evaluate. So that's why, I mean, we can give you the freedom to choose your group, make your group. But for any group assignment or the group project, the group has to be the same. You cannot keep changing it. Okay?
Okay.
Any other questions?
So that 40% is like equally divided, or it will be decided later, the assignments and the project, the 40%?
That is decided later. I mean, that will be in fact done before the assignment and the project start. But usually, I mean, the project has a lot of weightage.
Yes.
So project has majority of the weightage. Assignment will be relatively less. Group size for the assignment is same as the project size. As I said, I mean, it will be the same group. It won't be different group. Any other questions?
Could you please describe the kind of projects you would be expecting from the course?
Anything related to information retrieval, we are fine with that. So for example, you can simply, search for, for example, a conference or international conference of information retrieval, or information conference of, say, CIGAR, for example. Just take you are free to choose any assignment, any course project that you want, which has some aspect of information retrieval, right?
So you will be providing the list of projects, or we have to choose by own?
We are fine. I mean, if you want to come up, I mean, we can also provide a list of projects to you. We can provide. But if you want to come up with your own, I mean, we are also fine. You simply have to convince us, like, why this is good enough for the course project. I mean, we can have this discussion once we start the project discussion. Is it fine?
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, but we are perfectly fine if you want to propose something new. And often, because we don't want to restrict yourself to the, say, already existing work which are available, right? Because you may have your own ideas. You want to probably try something new. I mean, that is also the aim of this course, right? I mean, we want to give you the flexibility to learn or probably build something which is new. I mean, one thing I want to highlight here as well. Usually in my courses, many course projects got published to the number of good conferences and journals, right? I mean, I don't want it to in fact show the examples now, but I mean, many papers, at least in my previous course, Multimedia Computing, an application, I mean, has been published to the many good and top conferences. Earlier I used to have some weightage for that, but this semester, deliberately, I don't want to give any weightage to that, because I realize that probably that may be a little bit disadvantage to the many people who are just starting. So here, at least in my case, I mean, what I'm at least in this course, and probably I want to try that. I definitely want to encourage you. I definitely want to support you if you want to take your course project further to the next logical step of like publishing or something. I will be very happy to support. But that will not have any effect on the evaluation. I'm not going to probably give any extra weightage to that. Any questions here? Okay. Assignment and project is already 40%, man. I mean, how much you want to have it? And anyways, I mean, based on
also, sir, I want to know about the marking scheme. Will that be relative or absolute marking scheme?
It will be relative. I just answered this sometime back. Yeah, it will be relative. Okay.
Right, sir.
Anything else? If not, then let me go ahead because I believe we have not more than 5 to 10 minutes. 10 minutes. So let me cover rest of the slides. Let's see how much we can.
So can you please tell us a curriculum, like what all things will be taught in this class?
Sir, this textbook is like a reference book or a complete textbook we can like take from the library and just follow this?
Yeah, so let me come to that. If you go to this book, so the books chapter, everything is available here. All the course material, lecture videos, and everything is available here. You simply have to, like, this is the book chapter. This is first chapter. So for example, we most of the time following this this book by Chris Manning, right? So this is the reference book we'll be following. And often the base slides are available. That's what I said. If you don't want to attend class, I don't have an issue at all. You can refer to these slides if you want to. But again, I'm not using the exact slides. I will be modifying based on my need, based on my course. So even if you go to Tech Tree, mostly we are going to follow this. Have you looked at the course description, by the way?
Yes, sir.
So you can simply go to Tech Tree and look for information retrieval. Course CS5208. So this is the, you can say, this is the, you can see the topics. It's again high level topics that we have planned to cover in different weeks. So like in the first week, we want to cover what is the introduction of information retrieval, goals, history, and so on. Similarly, the next week onwards, we'll be focusing on the basics of IR model, then basics of searching, indexing, and so on. Right. We may slightly introduce some more details here based on the time we have, based on the how the class is going. So these are some approximate timeline when you can expect the assignment. So assignment probably in the week third and then week five and then probably later on. So and here basically we are expecting the project. And this is a project. We will at least the planning we will start earlier. The project planning, at least we can start earlier so that you will have some time to complete the project. Okay, is it clear? Any questions? Any questions here? Yeah, so mainly we'll be following this textbook. So what do we hope to teach? So this is what you're asking. So here basically, this is a kind of very brief summary of what we plan to cover. So how to do efficient, fast, compact text indexing, retrieval models. So like Boolean, vector space, probabilistic, and machine learning models. Evaluation, how your information retrieval results are. And document clustering and classification, search on the web, and so on. An introduction to some of the multimedia retrieval. If you have to move from information text-based information retrieval to others. So this is just this is my lab and my students, and this is my team. A number of students are working, some of the PhD, MTech, and the students from our lab basically are doing well, I would say, both in terms of companies and academia. So again, after course, if you're interested to work with us, we can explore the possibility. And we work with a lot of industry and academic collaborator. And at least as part of this course, I'm also planning to at least invite some of them to give some invited talk as part of the course. And that will basically also interact you, what are the things are happening at the other academic institution, what are the things are happening related to information retrieval at companies like Bloomberg or probably the Facebook and so on. So this is probably the last slide of today, second last slide today, given the time constraint. So I want to provide what is an overview of IR system. In fact, this same information system pipeline will work for any kind of information that you have. So for example, user need some information. So here basically the often user give input query. Similarly, you have a database which has all the documents and probably the related content. So information retrieval based system, basically it's a based on very simple mechanism, right? Whatever the input query you have, you need to represent in some vectorized form. And why do you need to represent in vectorized form? Anyone?
To perform mathematical operations.
Yeah, basically to just calculate the similarity, the equilibrium distance, or some distances between the other vectors of other documents.
Yeah, because as I said, I mean, in case of information retrieval system, I mean, you want to perform the matching. And how you can perform matching? I mean, you need some uniform representation. Because here, the input query, for example, if you're talking about text, it could be just Rajiv Ratna Shah, just three words, or probably Rajiv Ratna Shah or something, or probably for anything else. So input query could be very unstructured, right? And similarly, in the database, you have a lot of, and so for example, here the your input query have just three words, but here there are a lot of documents, website, and probably content, which have a huge amount of, they have variable length of content and so on, right? So you need some kind of uniform representation for both query as well as the different documents that you have in the database so that you can compare them. Because if they will not be on the same space, you cannot compare, right? You cannot find, if they won't be in the same space, you cannot compute the similarity between them, right? So that is the key. So for a given information input query, you need to find some representation. And in that case, basically you have a query in some form, say in vectorized form or any other form that you can decide whatever the representation that you will be choosing. Similarly, for the database which has document, you can have the index document representation. So simply, so for example, you have one query, and here basically you have 100 documents in your database. So ideally, in the brute force, how it will work? This query basically match with all the 100 documents you have based on some similarity matching. So can anyone tell me some similarity matching they are aware of? How you can compute the similarity between two vectors?
Cosine similarity.
Yeah, what else? Other than cosine similarity, what else?
There's the Euclidean distance.
Euclidean distance. Yeah, very nice. So yeah, so cosine similarity, Euclidean distance, and many others you can think of. And based on that, you have some similarity scores. So based on that similarity score, you can rank the list of items, right? So based on similarity, so for example, the query, the document which is matching most with the query can be on the top. And subsequently, for the remaining document which are less similar, will go in the latter in the list. And in this way, basically, you have rank list of items. And in this way, basically, you have the evaluation of the result and give the results to the... you provided the rank list of item to the user. And here, basically, as I said, I mean, if you're providing the results to a user for any given query, it may be correct, it may not be correct, right? So here, basically, in order to improve the result further, there is a concept of something called relevance feedback. User provides some relevance feedback to the system, and your query is updated accordingly. And so that once your query is updated based on your feedback, it can basically match again with the document, and you'll get again rank of list of updated list of results. And you can keep doing this unless you're satisfied. In real time, usually we don't see this happening, but internally it happens, right? So this is the overall an overview of information and retrieval based system. And in the future, do you think, as we have also discussed, this input query won't be only text, right? So what all thing you can expect as an input? What all thing you can expect as an input?
Maybe images, audios, images as well.
Images as well. So you can expect, you can say input device like images, it could be touch, it could be mouse, it could be keyboard, it could be gesture as well, right? It could be speech and anything. right? So once you have different kind of input, you need to basically you will have all the retrieved documents, right? So that again, so that could be in form of text document, it could be probably audio, video, or probably many other thing. And even it could be a list of suspects. So as an use case, let me
Example, the input is an image, the output is also an image, or it can be a text or something other format than the input.
So there is something called cross media retrieval. So when we say the cross media retrieval, I mean the input and output modality may not be the same. So for example, it could be the input is text but the output is audio, input is text but the output is image, and vice versa, the input is image but the output could be anything. So that is again extension of information retrieval, and that is something called cross media information retrieval. Okay,
right, sir.
Okay, so there is a use case for this. Can we think of a use case where you have to retrieve criminal from the database, right? So for example, police has, in fact, all the police system have criminal dossier. So criminal dossier have all the information about the, you can say the different criminals they have. So this particular system we are building for Delhi Police, by the way. So in that case, you can see you have a list of probably the so-called criminals, right? And you want to find this person. How this person can be retrieved? It can be retrieved by the text, right? Suppose you know the name, you know something. Similarly, you can also give input as a speech. Is there any other modality you can think of, you can provide the input to the system?
So fingerprints or maybe...
Yeah, like... fingerprint, and that's fine. That's right. You can say the biometrics. But you have seen some suspect, I mean, who is probably walking around, say, R&D block and steal some cycle, right? So, and probably you are the one who have seen that person. Now you don't have fingerprint, you don't have name, you don't have anything, a speech or something. What do you have?
Visual description of the person.
Exactly. So you have kind of some visual memory about the person. So like this person might have this kind of hair, this kind of nose, this kind of eyes, and so on. Can you retrieve such person based on such input? Do you think, can you retrieve such?
Sketch artist. In the police station, it happens.
Right. Abhi cycle chor ko pakadne ke liye, agar if you go to sketch artist, how much time it will take? How much cost it involve?
I mean, sir, if we have the information about like these people who have actually done these things in the past, then we can put them in a document, like information about the person, its image and all the gestures of him, like his nose size and his face, like what he looks like. And then if someone comes up with the details, like he has saw the thief, then we can put that information from that someone into the system, and our system will check with all the documents of all the criminals, and it can give up with the top 10 records, like these are the things that these are the people which are matching.
Right. So are you aware of any such system?
No, sir, not actually, but I have just thinked it like now.
Yeah, Vidit, you want to say something?
So you can use generative models like GANs. There are, I read some papers, like there are models which convert textual descriptions into actual real life faces. And then maybe you can use some kind of a similarity metric to check your database with that generated image.
Right. Yeah, so that's true. So, I mean, that is again a very right direction, but again, I mean, we haven't reached up to that that point, I would say. Generate, because I mean, in that case, definitely we can replace the sketch artist by just using some such GAN models. But again, I think we haven't reached up to that point. I mean, we have some papers in that direction as well to generate the face based on some textual facial description. But again, that is limited to mostly to the celebrity faces, because, and probably due to the lot of such annotated data which are available for celebrity, but not for the common people. But again, yeah, that's indeed a very good direction to pursue. So in that sense, we are running out of time. Let me show a last video of the day. So as we have discussed, the input could be in form of text, input could be in form of speech as well, just like Alexa system, right? You say something and Alexa basically do the processing in the background. So what simply does, it convert the speech to text. And once it is converted to text, it perform all the reasoning and all the find the relevant document, give it back to you. So that is something which can be work. I mean, so in fact, we have built a system for such system where basically you can get the music on demand based on your IVR system. So simply you say something, we convert that speech to text and you can get the relevant music for based on your need and so on. So let me show the video. So since we were talking about, can we retrieve the suspect from the criminal database using visual memory? So we have recently published a paper. Probably you may know some of your seniors here, Ayus, Meet, Suraj and so on. So what we have done, so often you recall the like the suspect, like only some facial attribute, like female, fair, black hair and so on. And based on that, your system can give the relevant images. And you here, you can perform the relevance feedback and you can improve the result and so on. So this is exactly what we have done in order to
It is imperative for the police department to automatically determine suspects from large criminal databases. Existing methods can retrieve images effectively, but not efficiently. To this end, we propose Seek Suspect, a faster, interactive suspect retrieval framework. Here we can see some images. Let us select one image randomly. We pick this image and notice that the person is male, has black hair, black eyes, a thin build, and so on. We will now use Seek Suspect to retrieve it based on our visual memory alone. This is the main interface of Seek Suspect. We ask the user to select a class. For example, we select normal black eyes, a normal mouth, a pointed nose, and a thin build. After selecting the attributes, Seek Suspect filters out the images and presents the user with a few options. The system also includes an image and asks whether the person is the target suspect or not. Here we see that it is not, and hence we select similar images as our next step. Based on our visual memory, we select some images and press submit. Seek Suspect presents us with a few relevant images again. In the second iteration, we find that our target image isn't the suspect, and hence we again select some similar images and press submit. In the third iteration, we see that our suspect is at the ninth position and hence choose it as our similar image. Finally, in the last iteration, Seek Suspect returns the target suspect.
Now that we have seen how our system works, let us discuss the concept.
So I skip the concept here since we are running out of time. And anyways, that will be too early for at the moment to show the concept. And yeah, so that's it for the today. And thank you so much for attending the class. So one thing I also want to add, I mean, whatever the project you'll be working with us, we'll be very happy to provide all the computational resources to you. I mean, definitely we will have limited computational resources to be shared among all, but definitely we'll be very happy. We'll judge your requirement and provide the resources. And thank you so much. And if you have any question, you can stay. And if you have the class just after this, you can leave the class and attend the next class. I'm here for next few minutes in order to answer any of your questions. And those who have any class after this, you may leave.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Any questions, anyone? Yeah, so does the website of Amazon do IR? Yeah, so everyone is doing IR these days. Any other questions?
Sir, in our ML class, when we were studying RNN, and there we learned about a thing like when we are writing, say, a mail in Gmail, while writing the sentence, the future words, means which we are supposed to write, is getting predicted. So similar work is done by Google also, right? Like when we are trying to search something and we write first three words, the next word could be predicted by using RNN models also. Right?
That's what I said. I mean, so usually at least on the Google that you see, I mean, that is mostly based on, I mean, the knowledge graph as you see.
So is it kind of
RNNs? Equivalent like knowledge graphs and RNNs?
They are not exactly same. I mean, because the RNNs are recently start people using. Knowledge graph, at least Google is using for a long time, at least in the last 3 years or so. So again, knowledge graph and all those, you can say, the knowledge discovery, everything is relevant. I mean, the RNN is more model which try to do some kind of time series mapping, right? Time series modeling.
Yes, yes.
So, people are using these days. People are using these days RNN as well for sequence modeling. That is the what could be next text and so on.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay, good. Any questions? Anyone else? Otherwise, we can end the class. Anyone? Okay. If not, sir, then thank you so much. Yeah, please. Who is there?
Yes, yes, this is Indronil. Sir, yeah. If I need to maybe have a chat like of 5-10 minutes over some time over a video call, shall I send you a mail?
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Okay, okay. Thank you so much.
Okay, then. Okay, so I assume there is no more questions. So thank you so much, everyone, and have a good day. Bye-bye.
Bye, sir.